the old days, they used to say, no Bucks, no Buck Rogers. What I like to say is, when it comes to space, nobody stays until somebody pays. It really does get down to the bottom line. We can have all the dreams we want. We can have the greatest imaginary future that we want. But somehow, there has to be a profit created, be that cultural or financial. So let's look at how that's going to be done. In this panel, we have three great guests. Frank Salzberger from ESA. Frank was with Apple. He was an IT entrepreneur, and now he's with European Space Agency. He's worked on 420 startups. Right now, he's cranking out about 100, 130 startups a year here in Europe. You have Marek Johannes. Marek got his master's in London, and he's had a management consultancy before he and his brother and his father started Metatron, which is one of Europe's first family funds, and a very innovative company, and very imaginative, because they had the creativity to invest in my company, full disclosure. Then we have Yuya Nakamura, and Yuya comes from Tokyo University, where he worked on several CubeSat projects. His company is Axel Space. So what we're going to do first is I'm going to ask each one of these gentlemen to tell us a little bit about their company and their organization and themselves, and then we're going to have a discussion about what's happening in space, how we can make it go faster, what it's going to cost, and who it's going to benefit. So Frank, we'll go ahead and start with you, sir.
Okay, thank you so much, Rick. European Space Agency, we do everything related to space, human spaceflight, telecommunication, Earth observation, science. And what we also do, and as I was saying, I'm the head of the recycling office. In recycling, not plastic or material, I recycle innovation and great ideas. And in this respect, we support startups. Here in France, we have an incubation center in Toulouse and in five other locations. And this we do across Europe, because we do believe that startups and entrepreneurs driving the innovation in the right direction. And this has grown over the years, and we chip in 50K, where we don't take any share. We give them sheltering, technical support, we give them business support, and our logo. So we are the nice uncle with 50K in the pocket and the right address book. And being neutral really helps, because we just had the discussion before. Out there are a lot of people which I would call rather bucks, which are not really helping, which are rather sucking money out of the startups. So our job is, from the taxpayer money we get, to give a good share return also in the innovation part. And this is theoretically what I'm doing. And therefore, sometimes in ESA, I'm the alien, because we are maybe too commercial against the normal engineers.
Great. Mark, tell us about your fund.
Hello, everybody. Rick, thank you for the kind introduction. So as I will follow on what Rick said, Marek Johannes, managing partner and founder of Metatron Global. We are a family-owned early-stage venture capital fund out of the Czech Republic with a permanent presence in Silicon Valley and Prague, from which we use as a gateway for European investments. We specialize in pre-seed, seed, and Series A financing rounds. Truly dedicated to early stage venture capital across a number of industries. We tend to be industry agnostic and technology agnostic, investing in software and hardware technologies and space industry included here with a great company that was founded by Rick a couple of years ago.
Great. Yuya.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Yuya Nakamura from Axel Space. Axel Space is a Tokyo-based startup founded in 2008. And we develop in microsatellites. Do you know microsatellites? It's about the satellites weighing, you know, range from, you know, 50 kilogram to 100 kilogram. And we started a company, you know, with a project with the Weather News, which is the private company in Japan. The Weather News is the world's largest weather information company. But our satellite is not for weather forecast. We're monitoring the icebergs in the Arctic Ocean. You know, due to the global warming, the ice in that region melting rapidly. And new routes, shipping routes, are emerging. So The weather news is trying to provide the like the navigation services for vessels sailing there. So they're using a satellite to know the ice distribution. So that's our first satellite, and we have developed 3 satellites so far, and two of them are already in orbit, and third one will go to space within this year. So we're now preparing for the shipping of the third satellite, and that is one of our businesses. The dedicated satellite business, and we're doing another type of business, and we raised $19 million last year. And we started a new project called Axie Globe. In this project, we're planning to launch 50 microsatellites in total. And we're monitoring the whole world and every day. So the frequency is the biggest difference from the existing constellation. And through this constellation, we're providing not only imagery, but also the information which is beneficial to a wide range of industries, including agriculture, forestry, urban planning, disaster monitoring, and so on. So we want to be a platformer. So we are launching 50 satellites. We are going to provide create a data platform, and we are welcoming the many software vendors. Which creates the own applications running on our platform. So that's our new business started last year. So that's our company's introduction. Thank you very much.
The two guys who are giving the money had very short introductions, right? Oh, I do this, and I'm working on this and that. The guy who's trying to get the money and has to raise the money is doing his pitch and his sale, and did it very well, by the way. But that's what we have to do on our side of things to get gentlemen like this to be supportive of us. So we have a few minutes. And I want to start with something very, very basic before we get into the actual nitty-gritty of the business. Each one of you, kind of round robin, when did you first get the space bug?
I think it was a friend showed me old drawings when we were kids where we designed spaceships. But he was showing me that when I started to work for ESA, because I said, Frank, you know, that was in your plan much earlier. But I totally forgot that because I was 12. So, and when I left Apple and I had my own company as a CEO, and IT was not going very well in 2003, ESA hired me as a head of commercial development, you know, and money was strange. Well, it was okay, but, governmental organization really is different than a startup company, trust me, you know. But I had a chance to work with astronauts together. You know, I know all of them in Europe. And I said, I was not married, I had no kids. I said, wow, this is pretty cool. This is a chance of a lifetime. And maybe I had the bug, but to really get the flu later, that was the time.
Great. Mark?
For me, the true first moment was during a summer internship in London in an investment bank when I read the first article about excavation of space resources. And that was back in 2006, 2007, I think. And that was the first time I really realized that space and the space industry was happening, and that it could be something far more tangible than watching Star Trek and Star Wars and then reading science fiction books. That it was actually really happening and could be a possibility.
Well, actually, when I was a high school student, I have nothing to do with space, actually. When I entered the university, I met one professor. He said that we're doing the handmade satellite project, and I was amazed to see that. And that was a starting point of my space life. And since then, I have been involved in several nanosatellite projects at the university, and that's the origin of my space business.
Great. So as we're moving into this period of time now where we're going from our dreams and science fiction into reality, as I said, we have to make it pay. Each one of you represents a different aspect of the field. We have the government institutional, we have the private investors, and we have the startups. Coming from the government side of things, I know in my world, in the US and for several years. As you know, I've been kind of involved in trying to get the government to, first of all, realize what the hell is it that I'm looking at? What is happening here? How has that been for you in ESA as far as the rise of, let's call it commercial space? We call it new space, commercial space. How did it start, and where do you think it's going now?
I'm 13 years now with the agency and slowly understand these beasts because it's very political, they have long-term goals. And trust me, when I was coming from a startup company, we had 350 people at the peak and then 250. So I was signing huge checks and had full responsibility. And then you come to a government organization where a lot of people decide and paper is really slow. Yeah, this was really bad. I would say they were still not able to assimilate me and my people. So, and you need that. So the good thing in a government organization is you have time. You can really develop something. And when we started 10 years ago with the ecosystem of entrepreneurship in States, we had 4 companies per year. Now we have 130. So the government organization gives you also time to do things.
Can I ask how long ago was the...
10 years. So 10 building years one incubation center, now we have 16, we will have next year 20 in 35 locations. We do it here with our colleagues from CNES. We do it in Barcelona, always with the local partners. It takes time, you know, to move a super tanker. My previous director, Michel Courtois, said, Frank, if you stop pushing, the agency stops moving. So you need people in this organization which are... And you need these people which are a little bit crazy, a little bit dumb. And I have a very flat learning curve. Yeah? You need that. If you don't have a flat learning curve and not continue hammering the wall, things will maybe not change. Sorry, I'm coming from an area where you have mountain farmers, very stubborn people, trust me. So, but the state is good because it can be the honest broker. A governmental organization like ASA can give... For our startups, it's not the money always they're looking for. It's our network. You know, making meetings with Philips, BMW, Lufthansa, KLM, doesn't matter, Statoil, Hydro, or Shell, or Total. Because we have that connection. And this, we always hear that from our startup companies. This is something which is valid. And all the governments, even the nationalities, are changing and say, well, when you're looking to evolution, we have to invest in startups because the innovation will not come only from our existing industry. And trust me, 10 years ago, that was not a fact. Now, I think everybody got that message.
Great. Yeah, so, with your company, your organization, I guess you would have to say it's not traditional for what you would think of as family money in Europe to get involved in an industry as crazy or as interesting as and risky as space is. You're probably one of the first that I know of in Europe that is actually doing that. What got you going in this direction?
Well, I'll approach the answer from two perspectives. I'll just echo a bit of what we just heard, that as investors we see far greater amount of startups and potential investment opportunities in space than we've probably seen ever. And we see different trends. We see companies working in low Earth orbit, and we see companies going farther beyond in deep space as well. So there's a real breadth of not only industrial areas that companies are going into, but also the areas in space. We are starting in phases in low Earth orbit and moving onwards, and we are already talking about expansion and the big destination goals. We're going to Mars, and we're going to move on onwards, building big infrastructure projects. So it's definitely happening. We're definitely going into space, and there are already startups now that are looking into deep space. So as we are trying to figure out what we are going to be doing in low Earth orbit and how we are going to fully commercialize and exploit it, we are already having companies that are preparing for deep space expansion of human activities there. And in our case, coming out of the Czech Republic, which is Central Eastern Europe, where venture capital as an asset class is starting to gain attractiveness just now, doing what we are doing outside of the country in the first order in Silicon Valley, and then in the second, investing in space, it definitely does sound crazy, probably to a lot of people who found out about it. But on the other hand, when people learn about it, they get extremely excited. And the reception we get is this positive craziness, something you probably know very well from your life experience, where it's almost like pushing boundaries of what is possible and what is probable with investment work as a whole. So for us, the experience has been very positive, and we don't treat space investments as investments that have higher risk than any other early stage investment opportunities, because the investments that we make to make a return at the end of the day, and they need to be based on and stand on the same type of fundamentals as any other investment. They need to have a sound team, they need to have a realistic business case, and they need to be based in an industry that has strong fundamentals for the appropriate growth and for the company to be profitable in the long term. And so for us, there isn't a differentiation between space and everything else or any other sector. The companies are all in the same line and then doing exactly the same thing, which is pushing the boundaries in their respective industries and innovating them continuously.
Yeah, we're going to come back to what you look for. I was just curious, for you, what kind of investors do you attract? Who was your first investor, other than maybe your mother or your uncle? But I mean, who beyond your family, who was your first investor?
Luckily, I found the angel customer, Weather News, so that we could, you know, establish our company, start a project. So the first 5 or 6 years, we worked with Weather News to survive. And it is just 1 or 2 years ago that the situation changed. You know, there are so many U.S. startups starting the space business. And also, the technology advancement in the other region, you know, I mean, the other than space, like AI or big data, mm-hmm. that will support the, you know, the environment of our, you know, business. I mean, we're a satellite developer, and our main mission is to Earth monitoring. The satellite imagery itself has, you know, not so variable. So what is variable is the information extracted from the imagery we take from a satellite. So to do so, such kind of, you know, AI technology or big data technology is you know, indispensable. Mm-hmm. So those, you know, everything, you know, every, you know, the technology advancement and the situation in the US changed the mind of Japanese investors. So that's why we succeeded in the fundraising last year.
I'm curious because you're entering a part of the field that is really fairly crowded. A lot of the new startups that are out there right now are doing Earth imaging. Mm-hmm. What makes yours so much better, so different? How do you differentiate your product?
Well, that's a good question. Well, actually, you can see so many startups, mainly in the US, trying to do Earth imaging business, but many of them are trying to achieve higher resolution, let's say 1 meter or better, and more frequency for some specific areas like the urban area like San Francisco, New York, or something like that. But in our case, we try to cover the whole globe every day. So that's the biggest difference. You know, the current Earth imagery business, in the current business, the customer needs to request to take a photo of some specific area. But in our case, we are covering the whole globe every day, so they don't need to make a request because we already have it. And the important point is we can not only provide the Earth imagery, but also the information, as I said. We can compare the today's Earth with the yesterday's Earth, and we can compare that and extract some small changes from that. That would become the business intelligence for a wide range of industries. I think that's the biggest difference from the existing constellation.
Great. Frank, you said that something about, to me, the fact that you represent, in the European Space Agency, working with frontier-oriented companies, commercial companies, that you're like the Adams family. Why don't you explain that for us?
And yet, we are the aliens, as I said, but when you're looking to space, including ESA, and Does everybody know the Addams Family, the monsters? Yeah, you know the movie. You know they're pretty cool, huh? They love tricks. Yeah, this is like the space industry. The problem is, for the outside, we are freaks, and this is what we have to overcome. So it was a great industry, and it's still a great industry, but it was a little bit going for itself. And we know that in farmers that self-impollination is not good for crops. You know, as I saw, they're coming from the mountains, and we say, saying in the valleys, never marry your cousin. Yeah? Nature does not like it. Because it's bad for the results, and this is also when we speak about innovation. It's like going on the party. The best party is the mixed pickles party, where you know 10 people and 50 don't. Then you have fun. Trust me, if you have a party where you know all the people and it's the 50th time, it sucks. So this is also with innovation. And slowly we see that our space industry starts to open because they get tremendous pressure. And pressure is always a good motivation factor. Yeah? And they get pressure from companies like you are. And you're helping them, which is good. It's like in the street with one restaurant, might be good. Trust me, a street with 10 restaurants, it's better. Better quality, better price. Competition is something healthy. So therefore I said the Addams Family gets competition. That's good. And we become normal. We are not special anymore. And for every, so space becomes normal. What you see, Earth observation is normal. Telecommunication is normal. Navigation is normal. And I think this is why we are really on the peak, and every startup I would say I meet going with big data is looking to space big data. That is much bigger what Facebook will ever do. And therefore I believe this is so hot, that market.
Got it. Yeah, one of the things we find in our field is there are basically two asteroid mining companies right now. And people talk about us being in competition. And we are. It's healthy competition. You know, it's like, we got to get there first and all of that. But the thing is that if you have one asteroid company, it's an anomaly. If you have two, it's an industry, yeah. Right? So anytime you're like, I saw a great video once from a TED Talk where the fellow was talking about the fact that the person that makes a leader is not the first person, it's the second. And that's what we have to have in our field, the second, the third, the fourth. Now you've got something going on. And that's what's happening now. The first person who gets out there and starts dancing, everybody's like, what the hell? But then you get the second, then you get the third, now you got a party going on. So that's kind of what we're going. So going into that, how do you, you started to talk about what you look for. Okay, how do you really get in there and differentiate what it is you're looking for? And I'll be taking notes, by the way. No.
Okay. I think for space startups, there are, in our case, there are three key criteria that we look at when we evaluate different investment opportunities. The first is the team. For us as early stage venture capital investors, the team is paramount when we make the decision. And in space companies, we like to see balanced teams, meaning that they are composed of engineers, business people, visionaries, and they so that the company is built around the core of an equilibrium of people. And it's not, so that the engineering is not too overstated or the visionary people are not too overstated in the company, so that one can really build a solid company out of it. In parallel with the teams, we always want to work with teams that have experience with either building of spacecraft, experience with launch, operation, servicing, or maintenance, so that we know that when we invest our money, it's not going to go towards the attaining the first order of experience in order to be able to go into space. We want teams that know what they're going to do, know the technology, and so that when they get the funding, they can hit the ground running and really progress fast. The second thing that we look for are realistic business cases. The business cases that are not based on great numbers and that are going to be attained sometimes in a great future, but business cases that are based on fundamentals of current reality, that in the best case scenario also have some cash flows coming in even before companies send their spacecraft into space, before they start to earn money from their core field of activity. That we're seeing a lot of startups deriving secondary forms of cash flows from their activities in space, selling data, selling licenses, commercializing some element of their activity that they want to do long-term in space right now. And I think that's very important because it shows a certain degree of business acumen that the teams should have, and also enables the companies then to potentially pivot or really analyze the market and how it evolves. And then the third thing, and that's for us as an investment company, we like infrastructure projects. We like to think of space as deep space. We believe that colonization of space is not a hypothetical anymore. It's a reality that is going to happen. And we are simply going through a series of steps now to get us there. And in order for that to happen, first, the infrastructure for that needs to be built. And that means telecommunication, that means resources, that means energy, that means infrastructural transportation networks being built up. So these are the types of companies and type of projects that we really like and we really like to look at, because they have the potential to really not only be the backbones of the new space, or as we call it, new space economy, but also have then the potential to be there for the long run and then really be big, profitable, and important businesses.
Yeah, one of the things that I've run into in a couple of years that I've been involved in this is what you guys all run into, I'm sure, is you have the person who said, there's two things that go on. One is, just give me a billion. You know, okay, you're done. And then the other one is, okay, I've got this great idea, conquer the universe, and in the middle is, miracle happens here. You know, and it really is important to be able to show that you're going to be able to get from here to there. You're actually doing that in your company in a way. You're going straight into revenue. When do you see things starting to turn into real revenue for you, and where do you go with that?
Wow, that's a difficult question to answer.
You know, you're welcome.
We are launching the first generation satellites at the end of next year, and we will start the service at maybe early 2018. And at first, we're just selling imagery. But before that, we're talking with many potential customers in the various business fields, like real estate or agriculture, forestry. And we're now establishing some partnership with them start the service to them smoothly. And so I think we will have the sales within 2018, but we can be profitable, I hope, in 2019 or so. By increasing the number of satellites, it's very important, because we are trying to achieve the everyday coverage of the whole world. To do so, we need a number of satellites. The first generation satellite would be just 3. So it's not enough to achieve our goal. So, but in our plan, we will increase the number of satellites up to, you know, more than 10 by 2019. So since then, I think we can provide a daily imagery in a limited areas in the world. So we're looking for customers who have some interest in monitoring those areas every day. So. So that's our plan, and we're trying to create new business examples of that. And that would create the first revenue. And after that, we are welcoming many other software vendors to create their own applications using our data. So it will, I hope, the revenue will explode in 2020 or so.
We don't like to use the word explode too much in our field, but I got your point there. So I'm curious, when you're dealing with the government and you've got this new creature called new space, a commercial space happening, and you're trying to work with a private sector entity that might be able to do something a lot faster and a lot cheaper than your friends down the hall. For example, we just saw an amazing landing on a comet that some people worked for many, many years on, cost quite a bit of money. whereas a commercial company might be rolling in at some point to do something for a fraction of that. How do you navigate between trying to create this new mammal at a time when there may be some people who, some, may be considered to be a little bit like dinosaurs? How do you navigate that, and how do you turn the dinosaur into a mammal, if I can stretch the analogy?
It feels like a little bit like being in Afghanistan. So you have a lot of friendly fire. And of course, there are people doing a great job in engineering. You have to see their risk adverse. And I think this is the biggest problem we have. Our engineers are trained to find the bug in the technical system, because failure is not an option. When we go to the startups, and I just got a number of the oldest incubation center we started, even a little bit before we supported them, they have a survival rate of 89%. Yeah, that is too much. Mm-hmm. Because we select the company, still like you, the team, and so on, so this we do all fine. But technology normally is never the problem of our startups. It's always the business plan, or the team, or so. But most of them the business plan. So what we have to start more, and this is the biggest fight in the mentality, we have to take more risk. And this we have to do, especially as governmental organizations. Because if we do not take the risk, who else does? The investors, the startups later? No, that's our job. And I have a good episode, or a good quote from a gentleman which is responsible in Austria for all innovation. And they have had a financial audit on their innovation tools. And I had dinner with him, and then he said, Frank, you know, this audit, they found nothing. That is bad. These are our innovation tools. They have to find something. If they do not find something, we do something wrong. And I think this is the perspective which we have to more understand. If you do something like Rosetta, fine, don't take risk, because you have the risk-taking must be much earlier. But you should be allowing, having in every organization, in every, especially the big corporates, an area where you can be creative and stay curious like our kids and ask the why question and spend money. Because when you take more risks, later looking to the revenues and the job creation, it will be much higher. And this is something where I think where we have to find the balance. It's the balance between exploitation and exploration. And it's hard to get that in one person. So my job is to push the agency. Trust me, the turn is not coming by the sun, it's come by the barbecue of my management. So, but you get used to that. So, but I think you have to group people which are pushing. Our new DG is pushing. They say, better to do 10 things and 5 are failing than do nothing. And this is a spirit I think, especially the government, has to restart more to be more innovative.
Great. Mark, I'm curious, in the Czech Republic, what kind of relationship have you found with your government as far as what you're doing, that kind of thing? Are they helping you? Are they neutral? Are they confused? I, when I was there, which I was, I found some very great interest, but you live there every day. Tell me how that's going.
And in terms of, so that has, I think, two dimensions, the answer. One answer is venture capital as a field, a whole, and then space industry and specifically. I think that Czech Republic as a whole is waking up to innovation and venture capital as it's getting bigger worldwide. So the government is taking note. They're trying to support the entrepreneurs in a certain way with various financial instruments. Because to follow up on this, I think there are a lot of people, a lot of entrepreneurs, a lot of innovators who are willing to take the risks, who are willing to leave their jobs, who are willing to go down the path of uncertainty and try to do something, and they just need that little tiny bit of support, that little nudge, little baseline where they can really jump off of and go. And I think that should be the role of the government and of the state institutions, just to provide that little seed capital or that little financing or that grant or something. And I think that Czech Republic is moving in this direction. I would like it to move faster. I would like it to be more, to have a greater appetite for risk and have faith. You know, I call our investments leaps of faith, usually when they're early stage investments. And I think governments and state institutions also should take the leap of faith with the private capital and also the entrepreneurs, because all the pieces of the puzzle are there. You simply need for them to also you know, contribute in a certain way. In terms of the space industry, in Czech Republic, I think we have had some successes, like with Galileo, with other institutions taking note. But unfortunately, we don't see a functioning ecosystem within the space industry in the Czech Republic. There are isolated organizations or government departments that are working on certain elements of an ecosystem, but it's not a functioning organism that would be able to support a number of companies, number of organizations. We do have the ESA BITS Startup Center. We have a department at the Ministry of Transportation who is overseeing the overall space strategy of Czech Republic, I believe. And so we have certain pillars there, but it hasn't really come together in an actionable and functional way yet for us.
Mm-hmm. What would the best thing that a government could do as far as an entrepreneurial company like yours?
Well, that's a good question. Is anyone from JAXA? No. Well, actually, no, JAXA. They were not supportive, actually.
Nobody's watching. Go ahead. Okay. Just us.
Well, just actually,
mm-hmm. I tell them, not just tell okay. me what we should tell them.
Okay. Well, actually, the government, the Japanese government especially, was trying to do what they are trying to do to support startups is like giving funds for just development hardware, and that's not gonna work because it cannot be used. So I think the best thing the government should do is to create needs. And based on that needs, we can make the satellite for the government. It's kind of, such kind of basic needs will help us increase the needs in the private sector as well. So in my point of view, I think the basic needs in the space sector would be most important. Mm-hmm. To start new, cultivate such kind of an entrepreneurship in the space field.
Right, so you need the government to be a good customer.
Right.
Right, so how do we make that happen? How do we take this? I know that some guys I know who have been working on a spacecraft involving the government, they're only doing a spacecraft that's like a $1 million spacecraft, but according to them, they're doing $50 million worth of paperwork for a government entity. How do we fix that? I mean, you know, you could climb the paperwork to space rather than actually use a rocket. How do we fix that? Pressure's on.
Thank you so much, Rick. I love you. It's my colleague who's doing that. Yeah? It's the first excuse. Yeah? But I give you a good example where I even threatened him. We have a guy, he's a pretty good engineer. And I forgot it. I have backstage. I can show you later. It's a solar tracker. It's a small sensor who always brings the solar sands in the angle of a perfect angle to the sun. If you buy that in Europe, it's 15,000. Tino and some companies doing that. So he said that I'm working for a company sucks. I make my own company, put two mortgages on his houses, and made this solar sensor as a spin-off for the solar industry, for solar concentrators, and sold it for 400 euros. And then he said, now I have done a serial production. That's cool. You know what? I spin it back to space. You know? You put it in liquid nitrogen, put it in, you see, oh, it works, cryogenic test done. Okay, you have to do some paperwork, so the price was going up. But still, it's 3,500 euros. So he cut it, the costs, into a quarter. And trust me, their companies and colleagues, they hate that. Because it kills the business. I think it's pretty cool. The problem we have still, and this we're changing at the moment by the pressure, when we select a proposal, the first question is background and experience. 3 people, 3 years. Whoom! We kick them out. And this is what we have to change at the moment. This is what our governmental shareholders are changing. Because we have to allow to get spin in, really in. And this is the reason why they discuss with OneWeb, because, wow, this is a quarter of the price. We need more than one of these units. This is why they're shaking it. So, and then the engineer, when he has a quarter of the price of the offer, he cannot refuse it. And this is where the government also will change. So I think you need a little bit the bug in the system, which bringing these things in, and then the government will accept it, and big industry also will accept it. If we support the crazy ones, the rest will. We supporting startups. We do support the startups, and the rest you have to do. We open you the door, yeah, but you have to close the deal. Right. It was too easy, yeah.
You know, a lot of times you hear the idea of people talking about how we need more and more successes. Actually, what we need is more and more failures who can then get up and be successful. I think the thing that actually makes the difference in a culture worldwide is a culture that allows you to fail, where you aren't losing face if you fail. They're waiting to see what happens. And the culture is designed about getting back up again. And I think you can actually see that across cultural lines in the world. Those cultures where it's okay to fall down are the ones that are moving forward, or those parts of cultures within cultures. And that's what you're kind of creating.
But really? But you have that. My son was going skiing when he was 5. And he was falling down, standing up, falling down. He was still smiling in the evening. So I think we have our culture, it educates it away.
Yeah? Right.
And in America, maybe not.
Right. How do you feel about that? You know, the idea that you've had to, you've probably had a couple things that didn't work, right? Don't tell me you just went straight in, everything's great.
When it comes to a space business, everyone thinks about the biggest needs would be, it would exist in the government, right? So I talked with many government officials about using space, but they don't have enough knowledge about using space. Although they are purchasing, many images from the existing companies like Digital Globe. So the problem is that, I felt about the when I do a business is that Japanese government didn't have some strategy about the space utilization.
Right.
Yeah, that was the biggest hurdle for me to do business in Japan.
Okay. We are getting close to time here. I'm just curious, somebody sitting out there who might be contemplating getting into this field or another field that's, shall we say, just as crazy, what would your advice be? We'll start with you, Marek.
Sorry, the question?
What would your advice be to somebody who out here who's thinking about getting into this field now? What would your number one or two pieces of advice, very quickly?
I would definitely say step number one, if you're really passionate about it, go do it. And step number two is what I did in certain cases, find the person or the company that's the number one in the field that you are entering, and get in touch with them. Get in there, get to know the people, find out what they're doing, how they're doing, what they potentially are doing in a way where you could improve on it, and then so that you can move on. I always have the philosophy of learning from the best, and really setting your bar at the number one spot in the particular field or industry, so that you can then build up on that and potentially go higher than them.
Great. What would your advice be?
Well, actually, it was difficult to enter into this market because you need to take huge risks, right? And it's also difficult to make satellites. However, now you can see so many startups developing microsatellites, and we're constructing new infrastructure. And from now on, the other types of startups can be effective. I mean, using those space data, you can create a lot of businesses running on that infrastructure. So I want all of you here to think about how you can use space data and combining those data with the existing big data on the ground to create new things. So that's my message.
Yeah, I would add to that very quickly. I was at a thing recently with Jeff Bezos, and he said basically he couldn't have started Amazon except for the fact that you already had internet. You already had the post office to deliver things. You already had all the infrastructure. So that's kind of what you're saying. Build off of what's already there and take the next step. Frank, bring us home.
If you have a crazy idea, just do it. Be stubborn, ignoring the things. Continue. And ignore people who say, no, that is too crazy. If they say that, it's like when you do something new, showing a friction is always a good thing to show that you do things right.
So I want to thank you very much for coming, and we'll see you tomorrow. Watch the news on space, invest in space companies, and go make something happen. Thank you very much.